Hello everyone and welcome to The Y Generation, a show where we talk about all the things that matter to our generation. We're back with more topics to rave over and our panel can't wait to discuss them. Let me introduce you. Sam.
Hi.
Michelle.
Hi.
Emma.
Hey.
And Shane.
Wu-Tang.
Now let's start off the show with a letter. This one we received via Facebook. Hey guys, I was sitting in the food court on my work break last week when I almost held up my lunch. There was a couple sitting in front of me making out so loudly I could practically hear the saliva exchange. They were giggling and gazing into each other's eyes and their hands were all over each other. It was so gross. I have a boyfriend and we managed to contain it to pecs and hand-holding when we're out in public. Am I the only one who can't stand public displays of affection? Bridget. Now let's see if we can't help Bridget out. Michelle, what do you think?
I don't mind public display of affection at all. Like, Barack Obama, for starters, is massive on public display of affection, especially with Michelle. You know, they're lovely, they're cute, but at the same time, there's a sort of etiquette behind it. I know, at the same time, I don't want to see a sneak peek of what's happening in the bedroom. Like, come on, that's too much.
I was going to say, you don't see Michelle Obama and Barack Obama making out. It's like,
I think I've seen him go for a grab now and again.
Just,
I'm pretty
just like
sure.
A sneaky
but it's nice,
grab.
It's kind of like the older generation. Like, you know, when you see older people who are like holding hands and you always think it's sweeter. But when it's younger people, you're right, they go for it more and it's a bit more.
I've seen old people like, go for it.
No, I think they do go for it more. They're a little bit more. Like, they care less, I think, what other people think of them in public. So
Sam, what do you consider to be too much?
Kissing's too much.
Yeah, all right. But put it in a situation. You're out in the city,
yes,
though. Friday, Saturday night, you see it everywhere. And you're either too drunk to even care or, I mean, it's in the city. Like, seriously.
But when it happens you're sober and when there's, like, kids around, the way I see it is
definitely.
What you wouldn't do in front of your parents, don't do it in public.
Yeah, that's
fair. I agree with that.
All right, thanks for writing in to us, Bridget. We've got time to fit in another viewer letter. Here goes. Hi, YGen. I'm so frustrated. My girlfriend is constantly on her phone playing games and checking Facebook and Instagram. Apart from being addicted to this game called Candy Crush, and I mean addicted, she picks up her phone every 10 minutes to scan through Facebook while I'm talking to her. I'm pretty attached to my phone and the internet, but her addiction is ridiculous and it's causing friction in our relationship, especially in our sex life. Am I the odd one out because I'd rather talk to my girlfriend than send her a Facebook message? Signed, disconnected. Well, can our panelists relate to this man's problems? Shane.
Sorry, what was that?
Onto it.
Yeah, look, I think Generation Y especially has quite a problem with internet addiction. It's quite obvious, like, you log in Facebook in the morning and you see everyone who's on the chat and you log in like 6-7 hours later and those same people are still there and they've been on all day. There's no denying it. When you're spending the majority of your waking life on the internet, there definitely is a problem. It is an addiction. So
I check it first thing in the morning.
So I do exactly the same.
And I don't even care about Facebook, but I check it first thing in the morning.
I go crazy.
As soon as I wake up because it wakes me up.
Yeah, see, I do the exact same. I check Facebook, Tumblr, Instagram, what's new? I've been asleep for 6 hours.
Yeah, but is it really our fault? Like, we were brought into this era where it's kind of like, my nephew is 4 and he knows how to use an iPhone. Like, come on, it's crazy.
It happened to us without realising.
Is it really our fault?
Like, we were slowly introduced to technology and the internet and then it evolved and got more complex with us. But because it happened gradually, we're now at a point now where we're caught up in how complex it all is and how much it's in our lives. And we can't seem to break free from it.
Can I just say, I was on a cruiser, a boat, in and around Palm Beach the other day and there was a 2-year-old who could navigate the iPad better than myself. And there was a couple of 8-year-olds there, and when we took the iPads and mummy and daddy's iPhones away from them, they sat under the deck in the boat saying how bored they were.
So that's just sad.
That's just bad parenting.
Like, a kid's forgetting how to play.
But that's what it is now. It's a parenting tool. They use it instead of...
Then it's just been
lazy. Do you know what I mean?
Exactly.
Like, it takes over the role of parenting.
To shut the kids up in the medical room.
But then that makes it a necessity. So it's not an addiction.
I don't know if it is a necessity, though. We can live without the internet.
Yeah.
We can.
No, we can't.
No, physically, you can live without the internet.
People, we're not going to waste away and die.
I don't think I can live without the internet.
Okay.
No, you can survive without the internet.
Okay.
You can survive in society without the internet.
No.
Think of older people. My grandmother does not know how to use the internet at all and doesn't use it. But everything she does, she does everything without using the internet.
Yeah, but if you're ever lost or anything, if you don't know, the meaning of a word, you immediately go on Google, what is the meaning of this?
Yeah, but should you? That's what I'm saying. You can still find it out through other ways.
You know, there was once this mythical time, like long ago in the 90s, where we just didn't have it and we were all fine, and that was us, and we all did fine without it.
You mean like when we used to push bike ride down to our friend's house and knock on the door?
I know, it's almost like just in another world now, isn't it?
Let me put this question to the panel. Shane, I'll ask you, do you think guys or girls are more addicted to the internet?
Personally, I will say girls are more addicted to the internet, I think.
Instagram.
Why?
Because us guys are just there to browse photos. And that's about it.
What about gaming on the internet?
Gaming on the internet, okay, all right. Well, then if we break away from social media, guys definitely are more inclined to be addicted to video games. I can say that out of like...
So that's still the internet. So social media is more of a female thing, but the internet in general, goes both ways, so it's not really a female
Bottom line is the internet is just this all-encompassing monster that has just absorbed us all, and we cannot break free from its clutches.
So how do you think we're going to help disconnected?
I don't know, because that letter sounded like it was written by my boyfriend, because I am obsessed with Candy Crush, and I play all the time.
Do you spend money for these games?
No.
Do you know what, though? I heard on the radio the other day, a lady called up about her addiction to Candy Crush, and she spent over $300.
What?
She's an idiot.
See a lot of couples now, you go out to a restaurant or something, and you'll see them, they'll have their phones in the middle of the table.
No phones.
But they do this thing. They do this thing where the first one to touch their phone pays for the meal.
Oh, my friends and I do that.
Yeah, and I thought, that's an interesting way to do it. Because your phone's sitting there, like, now we have to have a conversation. When was the last time we had a conversation?
But I don't know how to help Bridget, because my addiction's just as bad as
disconnected.
Hers, probably.
Sorry,
delete the app.
Disconnected.
Delete the app.
Well, unfortunately, guys, we've run out of time for that topic. It definitely got our panelists talking. We'll be right back after the break with more of the Y Generation. Don't go away. We're back with more of the Y Generation. Now, have you ever been hit with stereotypical views from the older gens just because you're from Gen Y? We'll talk about one of the favourite things they like to bring up in our next segment, To Be or Not To Be Y. We sent our reporter Jess out to see what people really think about Gen Y and whether they are out of control in their behaviours and attitudes.
I think parents have just lost the plot with it now. And as I said, we're being told you're not to hit them. These poor teachers go through hell with children and young people nowadays.
I don't think they are out of control. I just honestly think they just have different morals, different views, different opinions. The world's changing. Everything's constantly changing.
Definitely. When it comes to alcohol, drugs, and peer pressure in society, definitely.
Absolutely not. No, I think small minority ruin it for the crowd, and I think that's the same across the most generations.
Wow, interesting mix there. What are your thoughts on this, Sam?
Yeah, notice how all of the older people had stereotypical views of us and all the young people defending us in that.
Bloody Jude.
She's at it again.
No, but it's true. I don't think it's a generational thing. I think some people are more out of control than the rest of us, but I don't think it's a generational thing.
Yeah,
I think that's just across the board.
I definitely agree. It's like our parents are not going to tell us all their endeavours when they were kids, but
I bet they
were either worse than us or as bad as some of us.
Emma, you sounded like you had something to say.
Oh, so the guy who's just like, oh yeah, you know, more peer pressure and drugs and alcohol, as if they didn't go through the same thing. I mean,
but again, I think we've been put in a situation where there are new drugs, there are so many different types of alcohol, and again, I think it's kind of like, yeah, okay, maybe we do take a lot more drugs than it was, you know. Maybe like 50 years ago, it was only marijuana, and now we have, you know, we have pills, we have cocaine, and we have all these different types of drugs. But at the same time,
so you think drugs are making us out of control?
Maybe, because we're exposed to them more, because that's what comes with new times. So, yes, maybe our behaviours are kind of out of control, but it's because our exposure to them is coming with new times.
I don't know if it's because of new drugs, but I think that there was a valid point there about not being able to hit your children and not being able to discipline your children as much and things like that. And you know how even psychologists now saying, don't criticise your children too much because they'll take it to heart and they'll get too upset about it.
Terrible.
So some of that I think could contribute, but I don't know if it's so much the drugs I think that is making us out of control. I think
So what do you guys think when you log into Facebook or YouTube and see videos of girls defecating on the ground at festivals? And
we're just off the rails,
just happy to be topless, urinating in gutters. I mean, it's not just girls, though. It's guys also. Mm. only Gen Y is what you seem to see.
But I think it's more seen now only because we have like the technology to put it out there. Yeah. Videos go viral now. Absolutely. That just happens. I think it's just seen more
thing.
Now.
I saw a thing in MX a couple of weeks ago. A lady wrote in saying that she was brought up in the 80s. Exact same thing were happening, just, you know, there was no technology to view it to the world. No one saw it.
So it's like only a couple of videos, but because they go viral.
Yeah, people are liking them, sharing them.
And then we get branded this stereotype.
Yeah, and the entire generation gets judged by what one person does.
I do think it is happening a little earlier than it used to, though.
Like at younger ages.
Yeah, I have seen videos of, like, 15-year-olds topless on guys' shoulders. I'm just like...
Yeah, like music festivals, things like that.
You know, where's your self-dignity, you?
That comes from what Sam says, though, and the way parents treat their kids. Like, you've got to be heavy-handed. You can't just treat your kids like they're angels because they're not angels.
Yeah, I'd smack mine.
Yeah, probably would. Yeah.
All right.
Well, look, I was smacked as a kid. I mean, I wasn't beaten as a kid, but I was smacked as a kid.
Beaten and smacked.
I turned out fine.
Mm. Yep, all right.
Well. Yeah, but seeing something in public, like, you know how I went to the shops the other day and saw a mum running up to a kid and she was threatening to smack him, and I was like, don't you dare smack him. Like, I was like, don't you dare, but then I was like, you know what, I got smacked and it was fine. Like, I was never
Well, see, the thing is, so upset about I was it. Going to Sydney a couple of weeks ago now, and there was a guy the same age as us, so you think, you know, all our parents, you know, smacked us, things like that. This guy, don't think it happened to him because there's one girl who had a birthday badge on, you know, it was her birthday, and everyone was standing up in the bus to go to King's Cross. And he was going to this one poor guy sitting down and just saying, how dare you not stand up for her? Like, stand up, give up your seat. I was thinking, this poor guy, he's ripping his earphones out of him, just like having a go at him. I was like, whoa, chill. Yeah. Like, I mean, that's just bad behaviour and attitude. Same age as us.
And I guess, I do see in the younger generation, like, they have less respect for... older people
but
as
how
well.
Much younger than us? We're 21. What are we talking about? 15, 16?
Yeah, I'm talking about 15, 16. School Gen Y. Kids. Yeah, but...
Still Gen Y.
Yeah, yeah, no, I do think that they do have... I do think Gen Y have less respect.
Maybe that's
now
more freedom.
For older people.
Maybe because, you know, as women have more independence, people want to be more... Like, you know, we have this new power. So because and everyone's kind of like, I can do what I want now. I can piss wherever I want.
Traditionally, it was... respect your elders, but now it's kind of like, hey, I'll respect you as much as you respect
me. Maybe that comes because independence, you know?
We do have a lot of freedom. Freedom leads to anarchy, so...
Yeah, but do you think our freedom should lead to, like, bad behaviour?
It shouldn't, but unfortunately, like, there does have to be a line. Like, a bit of authority needs to be laid down now and again. Like, you see so many kids, like, around, you know, shopping centres and stuff, you're just like, hit him! Hit him!
They need it.
All right, guys. Well, it does look like we've got time to sneak in another topic. Is it safe to make friends online, especially now that profile pictures can hide real faces? What do you think, Shane?
I will tell you full well that if it's Roxy Girl 1997, it's definitely a member of the Federal Police. And if it's Billabong Boy 1992, it's definitely a 40-year-old man sitting in his underwear. I don't think it's really that safe to make friends on the internet. It's like with anything. It's like buying anything. You definitely want to see it before you know, commit yourself to anything, that's for sure.
I definitely agree with you, but you think of how many gamers nowadays, you know, like doing World of Warcraft and things like that, they all consider them to all be friends online. Like, you may not meet them, it's obviously not safe to meet them, I'm not agreeing with go out and meet them, but I'm just saying they make so many friends, that, like friends. That's what I'm saying.
That they wouldn't normally make.
Exactly, they wouldn't go out, but they make friends online, they consider them to be friends. So would you consider that making friends online being safe, or is it just meeting them?
But are they really friends?
Well, they do become,
they
yeah.
Yeah, they can
like,
yeah.
I'm friends. How can you be friends with someone you've never met?
I have a friend who had gamer friends in New Zealand, and he recently went over and hung out with them, and they got along famously.
There you go.
So, but, going back to what Michelle said, like, you can make friends online, but how do you know who they really are?
You don't. That's a risk
That's
you take.
That's right. But how do you know if they're your friends or not?
Yeah, but at the same time, like, it's new times. It's like, we're Gen Y, we're supposed to be taking on all these, you know, new technology on board and be like, hey, I can use it and
I think
it's
you
okay.
can use it in a good way, but I don't know that making friends online is such a safe thing to do.
If I'm
Look
15,
at all of the, like,
having
cyber
sex with a guy,
things.
Like, okay, this guy obviously isn't good news. He's not my friend. But if I'm, like, if there are certain channels that make it safe to be friends. So maybe some things it's okay and some things
I just don't know if young people
about.
Can differentiate between
That's the thing.
A is danger
it,
and
Is it different for kids to make friends online as opposed to adults making friends online?
Yeah, well, what about like dating sites and things like that? Mm. You've never met them and then they're just like, no, we'll meet you up, you know, go out and meet these people. Yeah. And they're adults, so what makes the difference? What's the difference?
But then when children are involved, yeah. children can definitely be taken advantage
or
of.
Or even so. Teenagers, I mean, there was a female killed in Campbelltown recently. Yeah, they found her in a creek, and she could not differentiate before, but between a good person online and a bad person online.
But, but I don't see anything. Like, I would never be like, oh, like, you met your husband online, like, oh, I'm going to judge you, because I have a friend and, you know, she's quite shy when it comes to meeting people, and she doesn't like the clubbing scene, she doesn't like bars, and she started using these dating websites as a tool to meet, you know, to meet suitors. But it's like, get out there, meet these people, and it's lovely. And I'm happy for her to have met a couple people through this, you know, avenue. And, you know, I think we should be open to these kind of things.
So you think it's safe?
Do dating sites do background checks?
Well, I think she's on the fairly mainstream ones, which I think, what is it, like matchmaker.com and Reserve. Reserve
something? RSVP.
No? Yeah, that's it, RSVP.
Deserve your spot.
But I think she uses those ones. Again, like, you have to be safe, public places when you meet up, stuff like that. But it's hard for her to meet people in person. So I respect her for that.
All right, next up, we discuss the controversial topic of asylum seekers. You won't want to miss this. See you after the break. Welcome back to the Y Generation. Earlier in the show, we spoke about relationships and the internet, but this is the segment we show off our more serious side. An increasing number of asylum seekers are fleeing their countries and heading into Australian waters. Being intercepted by the Australian Navy, these boats are dangerous and lives are often lost overboard. Should we continue to allow these asylum seekers, or boat people as they are often referred to, into Australia? Or should we turn the boats back and only allow in those who have applied for a visa? Let's put it to the panel. Michelle.
Okay. I'm going to start off with that I don't appreciate the term boat people. I think it's a derogatory term. Mm-hmm. I think there's a sort of depiction that falls with that, and I think it leaves a negative impact on the Australian audience, because at the moment, during this time, especially of crisis with this, you know, topic, people are going home and people are unsure whether or not these people deserve relief. And so then you have this term boat people, and it's just such an ugly word.
Where do you think the word came from? I just want to ask.
What, boat people?
Yeah, the media or...
Well, yeah, the media. I just think ignorant people are just kind of shoved words together. Like, it's just not nice. Mm. And I think it's just not doing any...
In all fairness, I think that people and the media use the term boat people to differentiate asylum seekers that are coming in the right way and those people that are coming by boat. I personally don't think there's anything wrong by boat people. These are the asylum seekers coming from boat.
But aren't boat people asylum seekers? Aren't they seeking asylum?
They are, but they're doing
it by boat. Yes, but they're doing it the wrong way.
No, I think that, but that's not illegal. That's coming by boat to this country is not illegal.
It's only not illegal because they're coming from an area where that's being threatened. That's the claim.
That's right, they're legitimate refugees.
But how do we know that they're doing that?
Because after they've been processed, do you know, in the last 3 years, it's been almost around 90% every year. 90% of boat people who come are found to be legitimate refugees compared to 30% of, like, people who come by plane. So how can you say that they're not coming the right way in?
I appreciate that they're coming from, you know, threatened backgrounds, and it is terrible that they actually have to flee their home to do that, but they're doing the wrong way. Like, there are people who spend ages and months going through the right process to try and actually stay here.
That's another misconception. There's no queue, there's only a small handful.
But they're skipping it.
Do you know, there's only 80,000 placements that the UN will
Sam, can I just say, the people who are coming by boat rather than boat people.
Asylum seekers.
These asylum seekers come without any papers, mm-hmm. without any identification. We don't know if they're bringing diseases with them. It's wrong.
But okay, that's why we have checks. That's why we have the security systems in place to go through those. And I agree with that. We can't just let anybody in the country, but once they come in, that's why they're detained and they go through certain security checks, health checks, identification checks.
But they skip the right way to do it. Everyone else does the exact same checks as they do, but they're skipping the line.
Okay, Shane hasn't said anything yet, so let's go to Shane.
Thinking about it. I get very sick of the term, the F off, we're full. You see it in the back of a lot of cars now. What happened to part of our national anthem, you know, boundless planes to share? Like, I understand where the argument comes from that we should be sending them back. I understand it's a big strain on our economy. I understand that, you know, it is dividing us. They are jumping the queue and things like that. Unfortunately, the world doesn't work like that. It's not an idealistic place. We can't deal with it idealistically. It, like, really, what it comes down to is how we want to be remembered in history. We already have a history where we did not treat the people who were originally here when we came by boat very well. There's a bit of genocide involved. But we stand at a crossroads now where the decision we make on how we treat these people will really determine, were we people who, when people in times of need came to us, did we turn them away or did we do something different and did we take them in and did we help
and
them?
And legally we have to. Australia signed the UN Treaty Convention. We have to take them in. We can't turn people back who are legitimate refugees.
But I think that they should do it the right way.
I also think, do you not think that it's rather contradictory that you're saying that we should let anybody come in by boat, basically saying, yes, everybody come by boat, when coming by boat is the most dangerous way and these people are more likely to lose their lives?
But I don't think they have any other choice. Do you know, there are 15 million refugees in the world. Like, I just don't think that people who are coming from harsh and traumatic backgrounds, you don't have the time to, like, if the boat's the only way to get out, that's the only way to get out.
But they go through so many other countries before they even get to Australia.
But those countries have a reputation of treating refugees like they do, like they can torture them, like false imprisonment, all of these things. Australia can't do that because we signed the convention.
Can I intervene here?
We just can't.
Okay, so we've declared that, you know, it's wrong, boat, it's dangerous, whatever. Okay, we've skimmed the surface. Australia is a first world nation, okay? So don't we have some sort of responsibility? Don't we know better to, you know, in some sort of way, shouldn't we be helping alleviate, you know, the suffering that these people have gone through, you know, underneath all these, like, regimes, you know, these harsh regimes and civil wars? Like, shouldn't we know better? And I think the biggest mistake that we could make is to, you know, turn boats around, because I think it sends the wrong message to Australians. Like, you know, these kids, like, is it right? Is it wrong? Should we help these people? Should we give them relief? Shouldn't we? And I think it's the wrong message to send people outside from Australia. You know, at the end of the day, like, Indonesia is not going to agree with this policy. So we're going to be doing
it
alone.
There's a lot of concern that Indonesia's government are becoming very upset with the way that we're dealing with it. And there's a lot of concern that it'll create a lot of tension if we do start turning the boats around. The last thing we need is a conflict between Australia and another country, because that hasn't happened before. We probably would not be in a great position.
I just think that Australians have this fear that people are going to invade our country and take all of our resources. I think that's what it is. But we accept, like, such a small percentage of refugees. Like,
There's still a right way to do it. I'm not saying, you know, send them back to their country, you know, where they are in such a threatened area, you know. I still appreciate that. But there's a right way to do it. A lot of people are doing it the right way and they're spending just as much. They're putting their whole life savings in to come by boat. Why don't they put their whole life savings to come the proper way?
Sam, just in regards to what you were saying, I read in the Courier Mail that our government funds caseworkers who pick boat people up. They help them find accommodation. They set them up with Medicare, provide orientation classes. And after the first 6 weeks, they're left to survive on $220 a week, taxpayers' money. Also, they have church and ethnic communities pitching in. Now, do you think that it's wrong that Australians...
I think that people who have been accepted into our country, and those people have been found to be legitimate refugees after going through all of the checks, I think they should have assistance in the community.
I think
what
I was going to finish saying was that if we say, OK, let all the boats in, we will have thousands more people coming to our country.
I don't think domestic policy is the biggest factor in people coming to Australia. I don't think that that's the biggest factor. I think it's factors like natural disasters, regimes from overseas. I don't think that domestic policy, like Tony Abbott saying we'll turn boats around if they come, isn't going to make a difference to the numbers.
But it might discourage people.
It hasn't in history.
It might discourage people from coming by boat
but
then being killed.
People coming here don't watch the news and think, oh, okay, Australia has this new policy, we won't try coming there anymore. That's not a factor
that's
for them.
That's not putting them off.
That's not a factor for them because their life is at risk. I think there are more important things.
Well, we do have some very mixed opinions on that one. And that's it for this episode. Thanks for hanging out with us on The Y Generation. We'll see you next time.